The 20th century really was America's century, if one thinks about it. From 1903 and the first flight of the airplane and the outcome of World War II, to putting Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin on the moon, and now an exploding biosciences arena. And as time goes on, other countries are gaining on us in science. And if we don't turn this trend around, the outlook for this country is not going to be good. Among the challenges America faces, probably the biggest, at least in terms of its breadth of impact, is our competitiveness. I had the good fortune to be the chairman of a committee that was set up to examine the competitiveness issue. The report we put out, the first line of it was called The Gathering Storm, and that's what the report has come to be known by. The way we be competitive in this country is really going to have to depend on our ability to innovate. And to innovate, we have to be first to create new knowledge. We have to be first to take that new knowledge and turn it into products and services. And we have to be first to take those products and services and put them in the marketplace. And that takes research, it takes entrepreneurship, it takes great engineering. And if we're not competitive, if we're not in first place in those fields, it's likely our standard of living will decline, our ability to defend ourselves. It really underpins so much.
So, is this related to what you were telling me earlier?
In effect, same as in silicon.
America's taken for granted many things, certainly our leadership in science and engineering. Even though only 4% of the people who hold jobs in the U.S. are scientists and engineers, they disproportionately create jobs for the other 96%. So, science and engineering, math, medicine, are fundamental not just to the people who work in a laboratory who are build bridges, but because they create so many jobs for others. If one looks back to the period after World War II, there were many great corporate research laboratories. There are still some. Just take Bell Labs, where they invented the transistor, where they invented the laser. Bell Labs, of course, today, what's left of it has been sold to the French. Many corporate labs have been shut down. The government during that period 50 years ago paid for about two-thirds of the R&D that was done in this country. As it cut back, industry picked up and now pays for two-thirds of it. But industry pays for mostly D, not for R. So who's going to do the R if that's so important? Well, the only remaining answer is our universities. Those of us who worked on the Gathering Storm report, and certainly myself, were thrilled when we heard that UT System would be taking the challenge on in its own right. We'd focused on the federal government and really hadn't planned on getting a lot of help from the states. The competitiveness initiative in the state of Texas was an example of one of the very first investments. Since then, others have followed. They recognized the importance of this problem and they invested in it. But perhaps even more significantly, they followed up the investment to make sure that those things that were promised were really produced. And by that I mean that the new science was produced that would help in the field of medicine, that would help in physics and chemistry, certainly in biology. The university had a major impact in improving K-12 education through programs like You Teach. My own opinion is it'll pay enormous gains for the state as well as for the country. And I think the regents of the University of Texas system are to be congratulated as both the former and the present chancellor for bringing this program to fruition. It's one thing to have a plan, it's another to make it happen. And Texas has made this happen.